The book Maps of Meaning is filled with contemplation and documentation of psychological, theological, philosophical, and religious topics. Just to be absolutely clear, in no way I am an expert on these topics, and I also think that's more of a reason for me to be making a series of videos and analyzing it, so that as a consequence, I can cultivate some impetus to learn and document my continual thought process. And also, obviously, on the side, I would like to garner some views. So here we go. Imagine this, you take a scientist with you and go to a park with him. And then you ask the scientist, "Can you please tell me what's hair?" And the scientist would reply, "Well, here we have grass, soil, trees, and other elements of nature." And then you are in the park, equipped with all the facts about your surrounding. Now here's a question. Does having all the facts about the park reveals to you in any way how you ought to act in the park? So you see, there's a gap, a big gap, and that gap exists between the knowledge of what there is and what should be done with what there is. A gap between values and action. A gap between articulated knowledge and embodied action. A gap between facts and values. A gap is generally filled by unconscious motivations and implicit values. In this framework, those implicit, unconscious, unassessed motivations and values are characterized by the author as chaos. This is essentially an extension of the famous is and ought problem, which was first discovered by the 18th century philosopher David Hume. And this is an ought problem is referred to as Hume's law, which in its simplest language states that you cannot coherently and logically derive from a factual statement a statement of value. In reaching the statement of value, you have to take somewhere a leap of faith. So there is a gap, and that big gap exists between facts and values. There is a quote in this book which illustrates the past point which I just made quite easily and clearly, and it goes something like this, and I quote, "We need to know four things: what there is, what to do about what there is, that there is a difference between knowing what there is and knowing what to do about what there is, and what that difference is." For those of you who aren't aware of the author of this book, he's a Canadian clinical psychologist and Harvard professor, Jordan Peterson. In recent years, he has been this controversial figure in politics and intellectual discourse, who has been characterized by the New York Times as the most influential intellectual of the Western civilization. So the point is, independent of whether you like him or not, he's a big deal, deserving of rigorous analysis. So when I was reading his first book, Maps of Meaning, I realized just at the initial stages of the book that there is content in this book of staggering magnitude, which is obvious given the fact it took Jordan an approximation of 15 years to write it. So let's start the analysis from the beginning of the book. The book begins with the author explaining how in his teenage years he left Christianity as a consequence of its irrational belief system, and how afterward he adopted socialism. He could not rationally accept the premises of religion, and soon the void left by religion was filled by the socialist belief that economic injustice is at the root of all evil. Even though he admired the high-level socialist who had genuine sympathy for the poor, he soon realized those were few and far in between. Most socialists did not like the poor, they merely hated the rich. His socialist beliefs vanished when he realized the world isn't merely a place of economics. The idea of changing the world by changing other people is something that also troubled him. And soon afterward, it wasn't just socialism, it was ideology itself that was the problem. Well, anyways, the idea which is implied by the author here is that ideology is the false and suboptimal fulfillment of the big gap between facts and values. The way modern people circumvent the problem of infinite interpretation of what constitutes a valid value is by adopting a culturally accepted ideology that provides them with a framework that describes in excruciating detail what they should value and why. And as a consequence, they are liberated from the Herculean task of finding valid value and meaning in life. But again, ideology is not an optimal solution for long-term fulfillment. One may reply to these pretentious sets of statements that I just made that, if I can't use ideology for the basis of value, then what? from a grand perspective, isn't everything an ideology? Is it not the case that everything that has value as a consequence of socio-culture agreement? Well, this is a great place to introduce the concept of the collective unconscious. And also it's important as it's the basis for the rest of the book. The term collective unconscious was coined by the famous Swiss psychologist called Carl Jung. And according to him, it refers to the idea that a segment of the deepest unconscious mind is genetically inherited and is not shaped by a personal experience, and that collective unconscious is filled with archetypes, which are these inborn universal models of people, behaviors, or personalities that play a role in influencing human behavior. I know. If it is the first time you are hearing about it, it might be just too much to comprehend. But I'll give an example that might alleviate some confusion. Eric Newman was a psychologist who was the brightest student of Jung, and he expanded on Jung's ideas thoroughly. And he used an analogy of physical organs that elucidates the concept much more clearly than Jung ever did. And I quote, "The archetypical structural elements of the psyche are psychic organs, upon whose functioning the well-being of the individual depends, and whose injury has disastrous consequence." So what he implied there was that archetypes are just like physical organ. For example, the well-being of our body is predicated on the well-functioning of our hearts, the same way the well-being of our psyche is predicated on the well-being of archetypes, which are located in this component of our psyche from a Jungian perspective, and it is called the collective unconscious. But the only difference between the physical organ and an archetype is that an archetype cannot be directly observed through senses. Archetypes can only be observed indirectly as a consequence of our ancestors projecting them in symbolic images and myths, and later their offspring and their civilization preserving them because they struck an archetypical chord in the collective unconscious. So in simple words, the collective unconscious is that part of the unconscious that is shared by all of humanity. For example, take this animation. At the top of the peak of these two pyramids is the personal unconscious of Mr. A and Mrs. B, and just in the middle they have their unconscious. And at the bottom of these two pyramids lies a field which is shared by both of them, and that is what collective unconscious is. And Jung in his writing also implied that it has a biological basis. So imagine this. If there are patterns of behavior and personality that reiterate over hundreds of thousands of years, or perhaps even more than that, who knows, then that also means that our brains have co-evolved with those patterns. And as a consequence, we can apprehend those patterns without understanding them in a state of consciousness. For example, throughout evolutionary history, the chances that you would have had a mother is 100%, because having a mother is a precondition to existing. And obviously, if you don't have a mother, there is no one to give you a birth. And even if you are separated from your biological mother soon after your birth, you still need someone who plays the archetypical role of a mother. And even if you don't have that, you still have the idea of it. So that's a pattern of behavior with which we and our cognitive structure have co-evolved for millions of years. And as a consequence, the Great Mother is characterized by a Jungian psychologist as one of the key archetypes. This is a gross oversimplification since this is just an introduction, but a valid one. Why am I talking about the concept of the collective unconscious, you might ask? Well, it's because the whole book is predicated upon it, and if you don't understand it, then going any further would be pointless. The key takeaway here, and what the author is trying to illustrate, is that the problem of deriving values from facts can be ameliorated by exploring the archetypical contents of the collective unconscious. And that's exactly what this book is about. This book is an elaboration and excavation of the meaning behind the universal patterns and themes which are prevalent in symbolic imagery and religious mythology.